let's take out our Bibles and learn together.
We know that the scripture says to the people of God, come out of Babylon. And Babylon not only speaks about exile, and the reason why I bring it up is we are in exile. I think about the book of Revelation often in chapters 2 and 3. And each of those congregations, those seven congregations, each one was outside the land of Israel in exile. But we need to take a lesson from Daniel. And Daniel lived in exile, but he did not live as though he was in exile. He lived under the laws of God. He did not submit to the ways of the world or the culture that he was thrust into, but rather he lived with a testimony that he belonged to a kingdom people. And my hope is that that reality, not only do you know it, but it serves to give you a different perspective, to cause you to see things differently. And in doing so, you'll see opportunities to act, to minister, to serve, to be used by God for His glory, and to be an instrument of blessing. Well, we're going to begin with a verse. We concluded with it last week, but I want to have that as a foundational, contextual clue in helping us understand the rest of this passage. The second half of Exodus 23, and if you have not turned there, please take out your Bibles once more and look with me to Exodus chapter 23. We're going to begin in a moment with verse 19, that last phrase. Now, most of the believers in the world, they will ignore this verse entirely. They do not see any relevance whatsoever. But here's a principle that I often speak of, but for some reason, so many people do not hear it. We're dealing with one of the commandments right now. And that commandment, people will say, should I keep it? Can I do it? Do I have to? Am I obligated? Here's what I say. I tell you that you need to take all of Scripture seriously. And yes, you should take every commandment and apply it to your life in the way that God has commanded. And how do you know what that is? Not by listening to me or someone else. That doesn't mean that others cannot be a source of learning, but the Holy Spirit. Bring each and every commandment you find in the Scripture, not just the 613 in the Torah, but all the commandments of the Word of God. See, we should not make a distinction, oh, that is a Torah commandment, and either exalt it or say, oh, it's not in the New Testament, so it's less significant. That is not biblical study. All of God's Word, did you hear that? All of God's Word comes on the same status, and that is His holy and inspired Word without error. And all of it is profitable so that the man of God, that means also the woman of God, can be complete and prepared and ready for every good deed. That's what we should think of. Now, look at this scripture, Exodus 23, verse 19 at the end. Lo tifashel gadi b'chalev imo, which means do not cook. And in this sense, it has a connotation of boiling. Now, there's another word for boiling. But in this way, it's cooking over a fire that the source of fluid becomes what cooks the animal and prepares the food. So we read here, do not cook gadi. What's a gadi? It is a young goat or sheep. And then it says, in the milk of its mothers, b'chalev imo. Now, some will say there's a difference here between this word and chalav, milk, but it speaks about a dairy. And so understand what is being instructed. First of all, I want to share with you that this verse of scripture, and I mentioned this last week, appears two additional times, so three times in total. In the Word of God. Again in the book of Exodus, I believe Exodus chapter 34, and also in the book of Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy chapter 14. And look at the context for that. Our context, a very significant passage. Now, I would suggest to you that what we're going to be studying in Exodus 23 is messianic in nature. And you say, what would be the connection between Messiah Yeshua and this prohibition in the Torah? Do not cook or boil a young goat in its mother's milk. Well, understand what this is speaking of. See, we need to not just rush through this verse, but you have to ask, if the sages of old, if we have generations where the Jewish community emphasized this scripture in a major way, maybe we should pay a little bit of attention to it. And here's what the historians have told us. Now, before I get into that, would you not agree that it is an abomination before God to shake your fist in defiance before God? We ought not do that. But this verse speaks just of such an attitude. In fact, this scripture speaks about a spirit of the Antichrist. Yes, I'm speaking about Lo tevashel gadi b'chalev imo. Do not cook a young goat in its mother's milk. This has an Antichrist application, an Antichrist implication to it. Why is that? Well, look at what the scriptures say. It just doesn't say in milk, but it says in its mother's milk. Now, its mother's milk was provided in order to sustain, to give life to this young born goat or lamb. So what God supplies for life, for sustenance, what was people doing? People were taking a young goat, knowing that this milk was for sustenance, and would use it to take the life in a torturous way from this young goat. There is testimony that the goat was alive. It was in its mother's milk and boiled to death. Cruel, barbaric. And remember this shaking one's fist in rebelliousness against God. Why? God says, here is the milk to sustain. And the person says, no, I'm not going to use it for sustenance. I'm not going to agree with God for giving life. I'm going to use it for the exact opposite. My desire is to take this goat's life with its mother's milk. It's rebelliousness. It was a pagan practice. And we see another example of that today. And that's with this whole coming about of transgender. Transgender is simply this. God makes someone a man. They say, oh no, I don't agree with that. I'm a woman. It is an act of rebelliousness. That's what this is. And realize there's a connection with rebelliousness and witchcraft. And that same attitude, that same inner condition that says, God says this, but I say. And it's in conflict. It's the exact opposite. That is an antichrist spirit. So this verse of scripture, what Judaism has done because of this practice of doing just that, cooking a young goat in its mother's milk and then eating it, it was seen as a pagan delicacy. And in order to tell the children of Israel, a covenant people, we don't behave like that. So for safety, they outlawed any consuming of dairy and meat together. That's a foundational principle in Judaism. Didn't say that this separation of meat and dairy and all the rabbinical application is of God, but give this verse consideration. Pray about it. And understand that it's not just in this application, but it has to do with anything that is rebelliousness before God. Well, let's move on to the next verse. Look, if you were, to verse 20. Now, verse 20 has a word. That word is malach. Malach is a messenger. You know, Messiah is a messenger. That same word can be translated angel. Messiah is not an angel, but he is a messenger. An angel is created by God. Messiah was never created. He is eternal. Yeshua is the eternal Son of God. There was never a time that he did not exist. So the same word, malach, can refer to a messenger or an angel. When it's applied to Yeshua, it is not speaking about a created being, but one that has been given an assignment. A malach has an assignment, as we'll see here. So look with me to verse 20. God is speaking. He says, behold, I am sending an angel before you to keep you or guard you on the way. Now, remember that word on the way. The word way is a very important word. Did you know that early believers were called the people of the way? And this term way relates to Messiah. We know that from, once again, the book of John, when it says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So Messiah is tied to that. And later on in the book of Exodus, we know that Moses, he has a moment of confusion where God says, lead the people into the land. And Moses says, wait, you have not told me, revealed to me, shown me this one that you promised to send. And this one is who we're speaking about now. Look at how the text introduces it. Behold, hine, pay attention. Behold, I am sending an angel before you to guard you on the way. This word guarding or keeping, there's another synonym that relates to it. And this is a word, nun sade resh, netzer. Netzer can be, well, it's the same root for the term Nazareth, where Messiah grew up, his home, we could say, his childhood home, till he was 30. And we know that this also speaks about the same word relates to a shoot from a stump, a twig that bursts forth. And the word can mean to keep. It's interesting. I was watching on television just today a show where different professors and historians and such were speaking about Yeshua, giving their thoughts concerning him. And they were speaking about Yeshua HaNotzri. The word Notzri comes from that city, Nazareth, but that same word means to guard or keep. It's a synonym for this word, lishmor. And what we learn is Messiah is our keeper. And he kept everything that God called him to do. He kept God's charge perfectly. It's one of the reasons why he's called Yeshua HaNotzri. So the term Nozri in Hebrew means Christian, but literally it means one who guards, keeps the instructions of God. Very important. So this messenger that I will send before you to keep you on the way and to bring you to Hamakom, the place. Now, the term Hamakom, the place, can refer to God. So this is God's place. And we know that because he says, which I have prepared. This is also very reminiscent of Yeshua's words in the Gospel of John, where he says, I go away to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you shall be forever. What a great word of encouragement. One that tells us that we have a godly destiny to enter in by means of faith through that gospel message, through identifying with Yeshua. We have a promise to be a kingdom people. So he says, to bring you to the place which I have prepared. Verse 21. We have that same word for keeping or guarding. And this is a command, so it's you guard, you keep. And the implication is yourself. But here it says, and guard yourself before him and listen to his voice. And do not, and here's this phrase, al tamer bo. Now, this word for, your Bible may say, provoke. It's also the word for embittering someone, being bitter. And usually bitter is a repulse. It turns people away. It can also relate to a rebellious character. We talked about earlier about that pagan act of cooking a young goat, excuse me, in its mother's milk. So God says, listen to him and hear his voice. And do not rebel against him. Ki lo yisa le peshechem. For he will not lift up, and this is an idiom for forgiveness, he will not forgive your transgressions. Why? Ki shmi bekirbo. Because my name, what an important word, my name means my character is in him. Now, he's not just going to forgive at this time. Why? Forgiveness. In its fullest sense, for a kingdom experience cannot take place until the cross and after the resurrection. So in this dispensation, we see something that's just simply a big theological word for time period. This messenger was not given at that time for forgiveness. When he comes in bodily form, when Messiah Emmanuel comes into this world, and of course we know he did 2,000 years ago, he's coming to be a forgiver. But here it says, at that time in the wilderness, he says, for he will not forgive your transgressions, for my name is in his midst. Rather, you shall certainly or utterly, it's the word for here repeated twice. So we translate it, you shall certainly or utterly hear his voice, and you shall do all which I shall say. Is that interesting? You shall see, you shall hear his voice and do all what I say. And this puts kind of a unity between this messenger and the Lord God Almighty. So once more, rather you shall certainly hear his voice and do all which I will speak. And notice, if we do, the benefit. He says, and I will be an enemy to your enemies, and I will be an opponent to your opponents. So it's speaking about, if we submit to this one, that God himself is going to go to war, he's going to become an enemy to our enemies. And to everyone who opposes our opponents, he will be an opponent. And he's going to show us in the next few verses how he's going to do that. But what's important is not so much how he's going to do that, but if we're going to listen to his voice, if we're going to be guided to that place where God wants us to be. Read on in verse 23. For my messenger, he will go before you, and he will bring you to the Amorite, the Hittite, the Perizzite, the Canaanite, and the Hivite, and the Jebusite. And what will he do? What it says here, and I will destroy him, meaning each one. Now, we would expect it to say, I will destroy them. But God is saying, I will destroy each and every one. The context is this. God knows all of their enemies. What's an enemy? It's one that I don't like, that doesn't do what I want. No, that's the worldly thought. An enemy is one that hinders me from doing the will of God. Understand the connection between the will of God and prosperity. See, false teachers say this. If you do God's will, you will be prosperous. What I say is this. Prosperity is doing God's will. Those who do God's will are going to be rich in kingdom rewards. That's our goal. That's the mindset. And that's what this messenger does. He does exactly what God speaks, to the extent you cannot discern his voice, the angel's voice, from the voice of God. They are one. Verse 24. There's always this prohibition against idolatry, that constant problem. Why? Selfishness. When I behave selfish, it leads me to behave in an idolatrous manner. Just that simple. When I am putting myself first, or when I have believed the lie about my destiny, my dreams, and I confuse that with the will of God. Now, God, does he have a destiny for you? Yes, it's through obedience to his word. That's your destiny. That's what you should dream about. Now, God can give insight how personally that is going to be manifested in your life, but that's the general character. I obey God's will. That's what being a mature child of God is all about. He tells us, verse 24, do not bow down to their gods, and do not serve them. And you shall not do as they do, as their works. So what he's saying here is that there should be a distinction between us and specifically our behavior. How we worship, what we do, these things are inherently related. How I worship is going to impact what I do. It's just that simple. And that's why it's so grievousome to see worship being polluted today, resembling rock concerts rather than a holiness. And here's the thing. If someone believes, and hear this carefully, if someone believes that we need to resemble the world in order to bring people, and it's always for the young people, that is false. That is of the enemy. That is thinking as one who delights in a calf boiled in its mother's milk. No, we need to realize what should attract people is the holiness of God. What should attract people is an opportunity to be led to worship him as God demands to be worshiped. And if people don't want to respond to that, that's okay. Because in my opinion, much of what is being called worship today is a stench in God's nostrils. It is not pleasing. It is not in light of his word, what he says worship is. So he says, look at verse 24. So important. Do not bow down to their gods and do not serve them. That word serve can mean worship. and do not do as their works. For, he says here, I will certainly, or literally, we could translate, you will certainly destroy them. This is the key. Destruction. That's what such behavior, idolatry, selfishness, following my own self-given destiny, that's what it brings. And that's why we need to stay away from individuals that do not rely upon the scripture, but use the scripture to give what I would call life coach principles, to be a person of positive speaking or thinking, to always be about encouragement. God's not always about encouragement. Sometimes God is about condemnation. We need to know that such behavior will bring upon condemnation upon us. We need to hear that. I need to hear that sometimes. So we need to look at all God's word and not say, well, I think today people need to understand, and this may be a biblical principle, they need to understand that life is not about getting more and more or being better or richer than someone else, being more successful. That's not going to ultimately satisfy. That's true. But we need to derive that from scripture and not use the scripture to justify that thought. Because here's the key. The power is not in my words. Never. The power is in the word of God. And that's why I constantly read the verse and reread it and read it 2, 3, 4 times before we move on. Because I'm more concerned with you hearing the scripture and implanting it in your inner being rather than you hear anything that I have to say. So you shall not worship their gods. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. You shall not do as they do their deeds, for you shall destroy them. And he says here, you shall break their, and the word here can mean a pillar, or it can be a memorial, a place for remembering these pagan gods, these pagan practices. And some translate it as idols. You shall break. Now that's pretty radical. But notice it's in the future. It's for the land of Israel. That the land of Israel was supposed to be distinctly different from the rest of the nations. And we're going to see where the boundaries of the land of Israel is when it is walking in truth. Verse 25. And you shall serve or worship, you shall serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your waters, and he will remove the disease from your midst. Now, I hear a lot about healing. Oftentimes, I bet that I get, in a week, 10 emails asking that question. Do you believe God still heals today? Yes. I'm going to say it again. I believe that God supernaturally heals. And this is a great verse that proves it. But notice what he says. It's when we understand. Now, if someone said to you, is it an important verse that God would bless you and give you sustenance? He would give you bread, that means sustenance, and water, that can mean to quench your desires, satisfaction. And then notice, heal, he says, remove, literally remove disease from your midst. That's great. But realize the context. It's an order. People say, why isn't there more healing today? And that's because there's too much pagan practices in the church and in Judaism. Just that simple. We're not doing what it says here. We have either misunderstood it and substituting something else, or we just don't deal with these things. And we don't see, because we're not led by the Spirit, to see the application of them in our society today. And that's why we're not seeing, to the degree that we should, God removing disease from, he says here, your mix, which would be our mix. Verse 26. And there shall not be, meaning there will not be, one who is bereaved, meaning lost a child. Now, when I'm recording this, it is Israel's Memorial Day. And this word that appears here is all over the news and papers and such, because today is the day when families who have lost loved ones, primarily soldiers who have died in service, I believe police officers who have died in service, people who have died in terrorist attacks, parents who have lost children. And this grief, this bereavement, is the normal word in English, is a word here. And God's making a promise. He's talking about there will be my order. God's order is a child does not precede their parents in death. Now, we're living in a sinful world, and that happens all the time. But if we were not living in the sinful world, this would be the norm. And that is that there would not be anyone who would be bereaved among you, nor barren in your land. And the number of days I would fulfill, meaning people would not die premature. Now, this verse has so much theological implications attached to it. We see here, just look at the last part. And I want, for the sake of time, to not draw this out. But notice what it says. And the number of your days I will fulfill. The implication here is this. If these things aren't being done, they won't be fulfilled. And that's why this teaching, oh, I am going to live to the full ripe age of 120 that God has promised me. God doesn't want anyone to die young or early or before that time. Well, that may be true that God does not want, but because we're not in a kingdom environment, but we're in this world, we see these things violated all the time. Why? Because of sin. Why? Because of idolatry. Because of rebelliousness. Because we do not listen to the one that God has sent, that messenger with his word. So these things, it's God's will, but they're not a reality in this world because of they're conditional. You need to remember, God's will is often conditional. If you do this, then, verse 27. And he speaks about a word of enmity. And this word enmity is also enmity that brings fear as well. He says, I will send before you and hamoti. Hamoti. Now, some Bibles translate this with the word confusion. But it's where we get the English word hum, to hum. Something, you drive in your car, you go, it's something's not right in my car. It's making a humming sound. Well, you're confused by that. And it usually shows a problem. This word is used for God creating a noise that scares people, that causes them to flee. They hear that and they run. And God is saying all these wonderful blessings when we listen to the one that God has sent to guard us on that way, this journey into this place of provision, unto this place of health, this place of no early death, no children being lost. A wonderful scripture. And remember, it's introduced with what? Do not boil a young goat in its mother's milk. So he says, verse 27, and enmity, or this word can be fear, I will send before you, and I will hum this terrible, frightful noise of all the people, what you come among them, and I will set all your enemies unto you, orph. Orph is the back of the neck, meaning you're not going to see them coming towards you for battle, their face, but you're going to see them fleeing out of fear because of what God's doing. It's a wonderful promise that God will defeat our enemies. Verse 28. and I will send the wasp before you. This is a plague of wasps, many wasps. Now they may be little, but people run away from them. I will send wasps before you and cast out the Hivite, the Canaanite, and the Hittite from before you. Now, this is, earlier we had six nations, now we have three. Three is the purpose of revealing something. God wants us to realize, if we do these things, then this is going to be manifested. When he talked about six nations, this is rooted in his grace, his kindness to us. Verse 29. But, he says, I will not cast them out before you in 1 year, lest the land becomes desolate. But it says, and the animals of the field will multiply unto you. So if all the people live like that, the animals will come back, and that'll be a problem for safety. So he says, I'm not going to do it in 1 year, but look at verse 30. Mayat, little by little, I will cast them out from before you, until which you are fruitful and you inherit the land. Verse 31. Now, notice that this has a kingdom implication to it. Because if you look at the borders of Israel today, they're not kingdom borders. Far from it. God's will is that Israel would expand, and Israel will expand. Doesn't matter what the European Union thinks. Doesn't matter what the League, Arab League thinks. Doesn't matter what the United Nations say. God has said differently. He is going to expand the land. And these are the borders. Look at verse 31. I will set your borders from the Yam Suf, that is the Sea of Reeds, or we say the Red Sea, until the Sea of the Philistines, Plishtim. This is the Mediterranean Sea. And the wilderness unto, then going from that, the wilderness going forth unto the river. And Judaism says, and most biblical scholars agree with this, that whenever the word Nahar, river, is mentioned, we're talking about Nahar Parat, meaning the Euphrates River. So it's speaking that the border should not be the Jordan River, but the border should be the Euphrates River. And he says, for I will give into your hands the ones who dwell in the land, and I will cast them out from before you. Verse 32. Now the implication here is, while they are still there, he says, do not cut a covenant with them or their gods. Don't make any agreement with them. Now, their only chance is to come forth and submit. You say, why would they do that? Because God has put the fear of the Lord upon them. Read the book of Joshua. Listen to Rahab. She says, we've all heard what happened at the crossing of the Red Sea. We all heard what you've done to these two great kings, how you destroyed them. And the people are paralyzed with fear, but not Rahab. She submitted. She participated in the will of God. And she entered into the genealogy for Messiah. What a blessing. So God says here, do not cut a covenant with them or their gods. Verse 33, and they shall not dwell in your land. Why? Lest they cause you to sin against me, that you serve their gods. For it will be to you for a snare. Meaning this, if in Israel there is allowed those who do not worship and submit to the God of Israel and his word, those will be a snare for you, and they will bring about sinfulness in your life. Now, this scripture, great scripture, my advice is to read from verse 20 to the conclusion, verse 33, of this chapter. And notice how it closes. For it will be to you, if you violate these things, it will be to you for mokesh. Now, a mokesh in modern Hebrew, and it's interesting, and I'll close with this. It's interesting to see the biblical word and how it has been applied to modern society. That word mokesh is the modern Hebrew word for a landmine. And just think about that. Why was mokesh for a landmine? Very simple. Because the landmine, you can't see. You're walking into danger, a danger that is destructive. But you don't know it until it's too late. And what God is saying is this. When we have that rebellious attitude, I'll do what I want. I'll misappropriate the things of God according to my thoughts, what I think is best. I'll violate. I will not listen to God's messenger. I'll go it alone my way. Well, realize, when you rebel against God, when you have an improper worship, when you do the deeds of the world rather than the deeds of disciples of Yeshua, that is, followers of Messiah Jesus, what's the outcome? The outcome is that you're walking and you may feel good, you may feel secure, you may think that you're walking in your destiny, that your dreams are just in reach. They're coming into a reality. And then the landmine goes off and Satan laughs. Let me tell you, what's being destroyed today for a lot of believers? Not their salvation, but their testimony. And it's our testimony that is a sinor, that is a pipe. It gives us access. When we have a God-pleasing testimony, it gives us access to the power of God, greater insight, greater provision from Him, greater giftedness, greater character of God, so that we can do more and more and more, here's the key, for Him. So let me close with this and ask you a question, and that is, are you prospering? That is, are you doing God's will? If you are, you're going to have a strength, you're going to have an assurance, you're going to have a contentment, you're going to have a joy, and you're going to have a mighty anointing on your life when these promises you're going to begin to experience in a more and more abundant way. Well, once more, I'm out of time. I'll close with that until next week when, again, it's midnight from Jerusalem. Until then, shalom, and may God greatly bless you.